Getting started with AI, you tend to start with a template, ties to some kind of repo. Our special guest, Chef Govind, is going to show us how to take it to a next level with software engineering agents. Chef Govind, welcome to Cozy AI Kitchen again.
Hi, John. How are you? Thanks for having me again.
Okay, so show us what you've cooked. Everyone probably knows Chef Govind. Just look him up on the internet. But he is the internet sensation for AI and cooking. So let's get going.
Sure. So we all start with some template to bootstrap a project, right? Usually. Yeah. And in our very own AI Foundry, we have a dedicated section for templates. But a lot of these are just GitHub links. However, we can do a lot more. So if you go to aifoundry.app, you can configure these templates that you just saw and more. And you can essentially describe your scenario and assign, break down into tasks.
Slow down a little bit here, Chef Govind. I know you like cook and eat very quickly all the time. So basically, before is go to repo. After is create software engineering agents to work on specially customized to you software?
Yeah, so those templates, the reason we use those templates is we configure them and customize them for our scenario.
Okay.
But what if you just describe your scenario in natural language and assign them to asynchronous agents that can parallelly work on that customization?
So you're not programming to customize.
They're just
SWE agents are programming
that
for you.
That's right.
Okay.
And you can all do this by going to aifoundry.app, or you can go to the self-hosted version, because I don't want people using my tokens. So I put rate limits on that.
Please do not make Chef Govind poor. Thank you very much.
Please, thank you. But we'll have the link below. You can go to Azure AI Foundry -apps. And in this repo, you can clone this and you can run it locally.
That's great.
And the self-hosted version has some new stuff as well.
Whoa, that's in the self-hosted version.
So we have this thing called SpecKit. It's awesome, SpecKit CLI.
Trending.
Exactly. You should go check it out. This is inspired by SpecKit, and I made some teeny contribution to SpecKit as well, the web version of SpecKit. So you can essentially specify and really work with specifications.
This is your special version of the SpecKit recipe.
That's right.
That's right. Look out, everyone. There's a special cooking is in that repo.
Yeah. And it also has integration with GitHub, so you can sign in with GitHub here.
Nice.
And you can essentially version control and
connect with them together.
Right.
Is a SWE agent now able to talk to my repo or control my repo?
That's right. So it would create the repo in your org,
right,
and then assign to Copilot,
okay,
or assign to other SWE agents.
Mm-hmm.
And here, let me go to one of the specification. Let's pick this e-commerce recommendation engine. And these are just markdown files. Mm-hmm. But the cool thing is, I think going forward, this is how we're going to be working. In terms of how we want to steer AI to build our digital experiences.
So you're saying that, again, I'm a developer, I go to the templates, I get a template from a repo, I kind of like work away to first get it working and then adapt it to my use case. You're saying, nah, this isn't that way.
Yeah.
You just, and how many software engineering agents get involved?
Yeah, so in this, I have agents that are pertinent for Azure specifically.
Whoa.
I have OpenAI Codex, which I actually maintain for the Azure binding switch.
So they all have different capabilities, you're saying.
That's right. And they can be trusted for long horizon tasks.
So they can do long running.
Long running. In fact, OpenAI just mentioned last week that they had an agent run for 7 hours.
Mm. So let's sort of like rewind long running versus non-long running for the guests here.
Yeah. So typically, code completion is nothing new. 3 years ago, we showed with GitHub Copilot how we can help you with next edit suggestions. And what we've been on this exponential where that next edit is getting more and more, like the length of that is increasing, the complexity is increasing. Essentially, these are, calls to LLM in a while loop with a bunch of tools. Mm-hmm. That's what we call agents. And now you can synchronously run those agents in an IDE setting, or you can have them run in GitHub Actions, for example, asynchronously, and you can parallelize. So you can compound your effort.
So there's many ways to sort of do them over a longer term.
That's right.
Right.
Yeah.
Excellent.
And here you can kind of see that simple specification with some of the how you may want to build that with the non-functional requirements and tech stack, you know, revealing your preferences. And you can kind of see how the LLM elaborated this.
Working hard.
Exactly. And from that, you can generate tasks. You want to bring down the work
instead
of assigning all of that one shot.
Okay.
Good, but...
Right. You're just breaking it up.
Exactly. You're breaking it up. And this will take a little bit of a time because, you know...
AI's working hard.
Exactly. AI's working hard. And then once you have those tasks, you can select those tasks and assign to whichever SWE agent, you know, of your choice.
And they can work in parallel if there aren't dependency issues, correct?
Exactly. Good point. Great point. We don't want merge conflicts because the output of their work will be a pull request with the changes that you requested.
Right. And are there also reviewer agents involved in that?
That's right. Yeah.
Okay.
So when there's a pull request, in fact, you can configure your repo for GitHub PR agent to automatically do a pull request. So,
where do humans come into this workflow of the future or the present that you live in, Chef Govind?
Yeah. So I think this is going to amplify our ambition. And I think, you know, if humans, most of my time I spend on understanding the first principles and, you know, because asking the question becomes even more important and verifying its output becomes even more important. You got to have a good taste. You got to have just the most, insane understanding of your end user's needs and work from there. Because you can generate thousands and thousands of lines of code, but that may not translate into actual user value.
And you have amplified your ambition. I saw some fine tuning on your...
Yeah. So we'll just finish. Oh, yes, pardon real quick. So you can kind of take the... Nice. You can assign it. You can assign it to different agents. For example, like one of the runs earlier where we took one of those specifications and we assigned it to agent here.
Mm.
And you can see how it generated a support ticket.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what we want to do is take it to next level, right? So this kind of goes into like we're exploiting the model's in-context learning capability through configuring, you know, templates and specs and all that. But we can also have it explore. So I have patterns here. These are multi-agent patterns so that through communication, agent-to-agent communication, they can discover new areas.
But multi-agent being more complex to work with.
That's right. That's right. Workflows and stuff like that. Now, the other thing that I'm noticing a lot of AI native startups do is blurring.
We're going to pause for a second. This is a moment here.
Yeah. So, I mean, we see this, like, why is Claude Code so good? Why is Codex so good? Why is some of the cursor stuff that they're doing so good? Or even our stuff? The reason is because it isn't just about API calling or some orchestration. It is about going beyond that, basically taking small models and post-training it with reinforcement learning. This is where the true unlock comes from. Because ultimately, like I maintain Codex, most of the stuff, there isn't much going on in the harness. It's just a, you know, while loop with tool calling.
Important RL, not Ralph Lauren, reinforced learning.
Exactly. And the way this setup works here is it just bootstraps your RL pipeline so that you can quickly get started. And what you have here is you can bring your own data set. A lot of customers that I have been collecting, you know, have deployed chatbots and they have user feedback like thumbs up, thumbs down, right? All that data, it's just sitting there. But that data is very rich to take a small model, post-train it so that you can get better performance, lower latency, and also cheaper, right? Lower cost. And what you have here is, I just have some sample data set, but you want to do what is called as data mix for this supervised fine-tuning warm-up. Sorry, these are all advanced concepts, but I'm trying to make it easy here. So let's say we have some conversational type of data sets that we want to search for. So I'm using the Hugging Face API to search for some data sets.
Oh, nice. So it's actually tied to the, oh, wow, that's great.
There we go. And you can kind of see a bunch of existing data sets.
So cool.
You can select them and you can configure your training run. Now, some of these hyperparameters are complicated.
This is the secret to a good model builder, you're saying, right?
Exactly. Okay. I think the new AI engineers, you know, are spending a lot more time on
okay. So you're like tuning parameters like this.
Exactly.
Mm,
and I've added some description to hopefully help out there.
Uh-huh.
But once you have all of that set up, what you get is a Jupyter notebook that you can take. Before I go there, I just want to kind of explain what happened there.
Right? Please.
So we took some data set that you, some telemetry that you, logs that you already have. And that does this thing called warm up. Essentially, I'm trying, it gets complicated.
Please make it for a stupid me. Thank you. Go for it.
For the audience. So what happens is there are these techniques, preference optimization techniques like SFT and others that may regress the model too much. So you don't want to do that. We do like the general reasoning based SFT.
Right.
There's a new technique called GRPO, which when you have verifiable rewards, you can create these things called graders. So the way it post-trains is it kind of clips the divergence, the technical term actually, and so that it doesn't regress too much on the other aspects.
So it's like a tower in Jenga or something, where usually when you're pulling things, they do whatever, but it's about choosing the right part of Jenga, right? Don't go here, go here.
And in fact, there's a new field also with mechanistic interpretability and neural programming,
right,
where you can exactly steer the model by controlling the neural firings.
Right, because if you let the whole thing fall over, you've done a serious regression.
Exactly.
It's now like, I don't know, I'm not a good model.
And that's what has been happening earlier with a lot of the post-train. That's why people were telling, were recommending just do prompt engineering instead of post-train. But now we can steer it in a much more controlled way.
Oh my gosh.
So what you get is this notebook. And essentially, when you download it, tells you everything to get started with. You can kind of prepare your data set and you can do that SFT warm-up and GRPO training. Now, you do need GPUs to run this. I have called out how you could use it either Azure Machine Learning or NVIDIA GPUs on Azure.
Perfect.
Do this.
Okay, so as someone who is at the cutting edge of cooking, you're like that superstar chef that's just trying things out. People may not know how to eat the thing. They're like, what is it? What should other developers out there do to get closer to your level of cooking? And you're a very humble person, so I'm just humble bragging for you. So what can they do to cook like Chef Govind?
So I'm going to say something controversial, but I do think all of us need to first go back to the first principles. Like, I am literally spending a lot more time doing math off late because the intuition of these, I mean, otherwise you're just tweaking some hyperparameters. You want to be able to read and understand research papers because you want to be research forward because things are moving super fast, right? So every day I spend a lot of time reading research papers on Hugging Face that are trending, things like that. And when you read those papers, you'll understand that it is important to know the map. So there's a lot more time that I'm spending on just reading. My Kindle is now my best friend. I love this time coding because I have asynchronous agents doing while I'm doing, you know, actual understanding and reading.
Okay, so you all heard it here first. Chef Govind says, go study your math and have your SWE agents do the coding for and with you. Thank you, Chef Govind, and stay tuned in the future. We hope to see Chef Govind back.
Thank you.